What is the future of truth and denial? It's my pleasure to welcome you here. My name is Stephen Smith. I am executive director of USC Shoah Foundation. That is the archive that was founded by Steven Spielberg in 1994 in order to document witnesses of the Holocaust, which today has testimonies from 10 genocides around the world. As you're about to find out from my co-host Claire in just a few moments, we have an amazing panel of people here to talk to you today and to discuss these vexing questions about this wonderful world of digital memory in which we live, which opportunities and not a few dangers. So we're going to be talking about this as a panel. I'm going to be hearing from our experts. At the top of this program, though, I'd like to set the scene. USC Shoah Foundation has 55,000 testimonies. We preserve them with meticulous care. However, we are preserving them on digital media. And digital media, as our CTO Sam Gustman will remind us many times, that all media rots. And so we have this ongoing need to preserve the past through the digital technologies that we have. But digital media also comes with some traps, and one of those is that it's actually easy to manipulate it. So on the one hand, while we are fastidiously preserving it within the data center at the Shoah Foundation, as soon as we introduce that into the internet and into the public domain, it becomes vulnerable to attack. And so it is a question that we think about a lot. One of the projects that we're doing at the moment is called Starling Lab. It's a blockchain project, a collaboration between USC Shoah Foundation and Stanford Engineering. And we'll probably talk a little bit more about that later. The idea being, how can we use new technologies like blockchain to harness the power of those technologies to protect our past and make sure its authenticity is guaranteed in a world where there is continual manipulation of digital media, including that of the Holocaust, for purposes of denial and falsification and so forth. Those are the big questions of the hour, and I am delighted that we are joined today, and we are co-hosted by Partnership on AI, and Claire Leibowicz is going to introduce our panelists to us. Claire, what a wonderful time for us to get together and work on these difficult questions. Thank you for your partnership today. We're looking forward to our discussion with you and everybody else.
Thank you so much, Stephen, and to the entire Shoah Foundation for this collaboration. As Stephen said, my name is Claire Leibowicz, and I am the head of the AI and Media Integrity Program at the Partnership on AI, PAI for short. And PAI is a global multi-stakeholder nonprofit devoted to the very broad mandate of responsible AI development and deployment. And despite our founding by the heads of AI research at some of the largest technology companies, we have cultivated a community of over 100 partners from civil society, academia, and industry based on the reality that we need multidisciplinary input to cope with some of the challenges that Stephen just alluded to in his opening. And I think this panel is a microcosm of that disciplinary breadth and a testament to the expertise we need to bring to bear on AI and society challenges. So as Stephen said, we live our lives online now, and much of the way we communicate or interact is through images and videos, or even here at a Zoom panel where you're trusting that what who we are is who we are and what we are conveying to you is truthful. And again, there's this moment that it coincides with this digital image-based reality where we can edit and manipulate imagery in increasingly sophisticated and accessible ways, ways that some of our panelists have been working in for many, many, many years. And this not only affects historical truth, but also our well-being, our beliefs, our political awareness, our privacy, and many other dynamics that I think our panelists will touch upon here today. But of course, what brings us here is questions of historical truth and the veracity of media today. And for me, I'll just start by saying the understanding of the Holocaust came through first-person account. And in many ways, I, like many other Jewish millennial Americans, am living testimony to that moment in time. My father was born in a displaced persons camp to a Hungarian Jewish mother and a Polish Jewish father who met there, really persevering after enormous tragedy. And when I captured that story kind of throughout my life, not only did I internalize it as something important to me, but also something to share. and the power of storytelling for actually certifying that experience of my family and many others around the world. And as I wrote in a recent piece in Tablet magazine, one of the oldest, so studying it is really important for us to do today. And also, Holocaust denial is not the only conspiracy theory to rely on manipulated media, nor is it new for us, for Holocaust deniers, to be relying on manipulated media to sow denial, but it's quite potent and still present. So that's what makes it increasingly relevant for us as a community to think about in the context of misinformation. So with that, our panel will think about three broad questions over the course of an hour. One, how is synthetic media being created and used? Two, what are the challenges and opportunities as well posed by highly convincing fakes? And lastly, the technical and social solutions for preserving historical truth more broadly, as Stephen said, of which the Shoah Foundation has been very involved. We'll have time for some questions at the end, so we invite and encourage participants to offer them and field those questions through Q&A in the Zoom. Chat will be disabled, however, and please note that this panel is being recorded, so you can come back to it if you want to digest what some panelists say in more detail. So with that, I'm immensely grateful to be with a group of technologists, social scientists, journalists, who approach the development of technology with a palpable sense of history, which I wish many more technologists did today. And with that, I will introduce them very briefly in alphabetical order. First, we have Chris Bregler, who is a director and principal scientist at Google AI, where he leads their media integrity efforts. He was previously a faculty member in computer science at Stanford and NYU, and he is even an Oscar winner for his work in visual effects. Sam Gregory is a program director at Witness, which is a nonprofit devoted to leveraging the power of video and technology to defend human rights around the world. He is a leader in the emerging threat and opportunities deepfakes pose, and he has run work around the world, grounding our pursuit of deepfake solutions in the realities of how the technology affects people all over the world. Lisa Roman is a vice president for public policy and social impact, at Bumble, an online dating application where she works on online safety, equality, and empowerment of women to make, quote, the first move in all aspects of their lives. She previously worked at Twitter and in government. Yair Rosenberg is a senior writer at Tablet magazine, where he covers topics across politics, culture, and religion, though he's a polymath and a musician. And his latest project is Anti-Semitism Explained, a wonderful video series that illuminates some of the biggest questions about anti-Jewish prejudice. Salila Saluddin is a national security lawyer at the Privacy and Civil Liberties Oversight Board, where she works at the intersection of intelligence collection, privacy, and civil liberties. And she previously worked at Facebook, where she led their synthetic and manipulated media policy development. And of course, we'll have Stephen joining us on the panel as one of our experts. So of course, the panel features many individuals with different and diverse perspectives related to the themes of this panel and Holocaust denial and misinformation. So first, maybe in reverse order, we'll start with Sibylla. What are some ways you're thinking about and working on these challenges?
Thanks, Claire, and thanks to everybody for joining virtually in our audience. We really appreciate the engagement and the interest in this topic. I think what I'll start off by saying is that the remarks that I'm sharing today are in a personal capacity based on my experience working in this space over a number of years. And from the time at Facebook and also from more than a decade in public service working at the intersection of national security and privacy and civil liberties interests, I think it's really important to start off by saying how important preservation of a historical record is, especially in the digital era. And one of the issues that comes up time and again in these conversations is the significance of the liar's dividend. And some of you may be familiar with this. And that's where something that is an established, almost incontrovertible truth is thrown into uncertainty because someone declares it or parts of it untrue. And the fact that a debate then suddenly ensues raises questions about authenticity that one would think wouldn't be raised. And sometimes these debates are helpful and they advance important arguments, and sometimes they are distracting to the historical record. And we can think of the Holocaust in specifically as a very powerful example of where we don't want this to happen. And in sort of a preparatory session to this panel, some of us remarked that, you know, this is September 2021, and we are 20 years out from the events of September 11th, which was a pivotal moment in US history, and how important it is to preserve memory for the sake of learning and for the sake of our future, as Claire mentioned in her own sort of biographical remarks, underscoring why this is very important. And I'll just close by saying that in the years that I've worked in this space, the one thing that is a truth is that multi-stakeholderism and having people engaged, discussions like this, both in the tech sector, the policy side, lawmakers, legislators, civil society, and also academia, is that we have to speak together and often to make sure that things are held to account, to make sure that the technological advances that we have are being applied in the right way, to make sure that we are aware that there's no one-size-fits-all solution. That said, are there circumstances where we need to be even more precise and vigilant in making sure that technological and policy applications are as stringent as they should be in spaces where it really matters? And I would say in the area of preserving Holocaust testimony and genocide testimony, there is no greater need than that.
Thanks, Salila. We'll go to Yair next. Who's muted?
I just wanted to thank PAI, Claire, Dr. Smith, the Shoah Foundation for putting this all together. You know, this is the sort of thing that I come to from the perspective of not just Holocaust denial, but other forms of anti-Semitic conspiracy theories. The sorts of lies that are told about a minority population, in this case, about historical events, about their past, their history, and the way that they spread on the internet, and what is and isn't effective for countering those things. And I think that the only way that people are going to come up with more effective ways of countering those things is to have conversations like these with people who bring different areas of expertise and different types of background. Because, you know, in my experience, you know, journalists can tell you one thing, they can tell you certain things about the way these arguments are made and the way they spread among different actors, right? But technologists and people who understand the platforms can tell you how that actually works mechanically, and also what sort of interventions may work and what sort of interventions may backfire. And I'm sure we'll get into the specifics of those sorts of things, which will make this much more concrete in the rest of today's discussion. So I don't want to go and jump too far out ahead, but I'm looking forward to having that conversation.
Great. Luisa.
Hi, so pleased to be here. Thank you for having me. Bumble, if you haven't heard of the brand, owns a suite of products that connect individuals who are looking for intimate relationships, for friendships, and for business network contacts. And the concepts of trust, truth, and authenticity, given this space of connecting individuals who hopefully will then take their relationships offline, is essential to how we think about the design of our product, the crafting of our policies, and how we are serving a community of individuals in which these concepts translate very directly to their everyday lives.
Thank you so much, Lisa. And then we'll go Sam and then Chris.
Thank you for the invitation to be here. At Witness, we focus on how millions of people use these available technologies that so many people have in their pockets, their cell phones, and other visual devices to document human rights truths. So we actually have a very similar mission in some sense to Bumble, this idea of truth, trust, and accountability. And how do many more people have access to that to tell stories, share evidence of human rights violations and the solutions they want? And the way we think about it is you need many more people at the grassroots level to know how to use these tools. And you also need to think very much at the structural level about the infrastructure they get to use to do this. And so much of that infrastructure is determined in Silicon Valley by the decisions made by technology giants and technology researchers. And that's how we came at that intersection to work on deepfakes at Witness, was to say, we know we have an emerging pattern of media manipulation that will impact millions of people we work with. We're trying to share stories of truth and trust and human rights evidence. How do we make sure that the voices of a global population of human rights defenders, of people who are not usually in the room when we talk about these topics, are part of it? And so that's been where we've come from this, is to say, as we start to think, how do we prepare for the next wave of technological evolution? How do we make sure that that is a debate that is driven at its heart by people who are trying to use these tools for good in a globally distributed way? How do we make sure they're at the center of the discussion? And that's the point of view I come from.
Oh, yeah. So I'm Chris. And my observation is actually over 25 years old. And when we got started in synthetic media, we built a prototype how to rewrite and lip sync John F. Kennedy during the Cuban Missile Crisis. And it was all fun and entertainment. And we worked with different visual effects studios. I admire the USC project, Dimensions in Testimony, and I know the technical people behind it. And it's just amazing how to bring in 3D, very immersive, these interviews to everybody, and you can relate to them. But then when we went the last 25 years to this evolution on this great tools that were built and are very fun and will change society for the better, as you know, 5 years ago, 3 years ago, people started misusing it. That's when I joined Google. We built a team, we built many mitigation techniques, but then we also saw that many other platforms and government agencies started investing in how to mitigate these misuses. And I still remember there's one program manager from the government who made a study 5 years ago to look at the academic literature, how many papers are out there that do the fun thing of synthetic media creating fake images? And how many papers are there that detect if something is fake? And it was, creation was 100-1, the ratio. And I hope in the last 5 years, we sort of turned the tide, not fully. I think more and more people still are excited about creating these immersive experiences and using synthetic media for education, for comedy, for historic preservation. But we see a lot more people are now recognizing that we also, as a society and community, invest in technology that mitigates it. So that's from my technology angle. And I cut myself short right now. I'm the last person and we should start the discussion. So.
Sure. Thank you so much, Chris. And oftentimes in the technology world, we forget the stakes, the high stakes of a lot of what the technology is affecting. And I like to ground our conversation in the reality of what Holocaust denial actually is and what it looks like and what it is that we are kind of up against when thinking about technical implications. So I may pass it back to Yair to really describe what exactly Holocaust denial is. Do we still see it today? I think a lot of people question that. And what? Why should we care about this topic in particular?
Yeah. So I think a lot of people, when they hear Holocaust denial, they think that actually it's a very simple answer. And they'd be surprised to know that entire books have been written about it, because after all, isn't it just people who say the Holocaust didn't happen? But the truth is that, yes, that is what you might call, as Deborah Lipstadt at Emory, who's the new US envoy to combat antisemitism, says, hardcore Holocaust denial. That is a real thing, and you would certainly talk about that. But a large amount of Holocaust denial, and this is the part I think that is actually more of interest to the rest of us as we broaden this conversation from Holocaust denial to other forms of pseudo-history and propaganda, is software Holocaust denial, revisionist Holocaust denial, or Holocaust revisionism. And this takes the form of questioning particular points or facts about the Holocaust in order to sow confusion about the legitimacy of the entire historical fact. So these people don't say the Holocaust didn't happen. They say, well, not nearly as many people were killed, and many of them weren't even Jews. And it's just sort of a made up story, the Jewish aspect of it. You'll have this other version, which is that, yes, a lot of Jews were killed, but also on the other hand, there were a lot of Jews who were helping the Nazis carry it out. And this might sound crazy to you, but in fact, there are all sorts of versions of it. people don't know this, but the president of the Palestinian Authority, Mahmoud Abbas, wrote his PhD in Holocaust denial. And by that, I mean not like what we're doing here, academic analysis, but in fact, arguing that fewer than 6 million Jews were killed and that the Zionist Jews collaborated with the Nazis in order to perpetrate the Holocaust. And this is not particularly a unique form of this, and that's a, I will bracket the Israeli-Palestinian conflict and anything like that. I'm just addressing it. You can find that dissertation on his website. But then you have people on the far right, and Claire, our host, has written about this, who will create memes about George Soros, the left-wing financier of the Open Society Foundations, who is alleged to have been a Nazi collaborator. And they will literally take pictures of real historical Nazis and claim that they're actually pictures of George Soros and say, this is a Nazi, right? He's a Jewish person who worked with the Nazis. And so this isn't saying the Holocaust didn't happen. It's saying actually, yeah, it did, but the perpetrators were not the people you think it was. It was actually the Jews, and they did it to themselves, which is a long running, you know, thing that has been said about Jewish people. They caused themselves to be persecuted. And a thing that's said about many minorities that are persecuted, that they do something that leads to their own persecution. And these sorts of like foggy tactics saying, you know, it's not that the, you know, the Twin Towers were not attacked on 9/11, but they were, it was an inside job. Right. So you start with acknowledging the historical act, and then you twist it into something completely different and cast doubt on different aspects of it in order to destabilize it in the public consciousness. And this is obviously much harder. I'm going to finish right here because there's a lot more to get to. But this is why what we're dealing with is so complicated and difficult, because it was just people saying this didn't happen. That's easy for an algorithm even to spot and to deal with. It's a lot harder to deal with the many permutations of, you know, the fog of doubt that is spread by all these more sophisticated actors in all sorts of different ways, not just about the Holocaust, but about many aspects of our history and reality.
Thanks, Yair. And to that end, I'm curious if Stephen and Sam perhaps can talk about why video in the past has been such a useful mechanism for dealing with revisionism and denial, and what the power of video, what it affords. So maybe Sam and then Stephen.
Yeah, you know, I think we've entered, and this is, you know, we're looking at, you know, 100 years of access to video in different forms. And as we look at different moments, you see different dynamics about video as a mechanism for truth telling and historical memory. And I'll talk maybe about actually the dynamics right now, which is around the world, you see many people who rely on video. It's the thing that people do. They take out their cameras and they film to film other people's testimony, or it may just be to ask them what happened, right, in very human terms, or to show the evidence of what occurred. And there are very complex dynamics around that, right? You know, do people pay attention to those videos now? Do they trust them? Are they being overwhelmed by an onslaught of falsified videos coming from their governments or from adversaries? But at the heart of it, people turn to videos in our current moment as this kind of, and Regina Rinne, the philosopher, describes this as the epistemic backstop, the thing you kind of turn to see the evidence of what's happening in the world. And I think it's very important that we think about how to first defend that capacity, because it is a very distributed capacity to tell truth, and that's what witness relies on. And then secondly, think you know, about the more complex task of how that turns into accountability, right? And that for me is really important, that, you know, when you're challenging both denial and lies, you're also in the current context often really continuing to pursue accountability, accountability for war crimes, accountability for state violence. And it's in that context that we really need to fight back at once against what Salila described, this liar's dividend, this ability just to reflexively say that something is false. And in pretty much every context where witness works globally, you see that reflexively happening. You know, in Nigeria during the NSARS movement, in Myanmar, in the US in response to incidents of police violence. And so, and what we've increasingly seen is people using that it's a deep fake as part of that reflexive response. And so defending that epistemic backstop of video and its capacity for many people to use it for testimony and evidence is pretty critical in this moment.
Thanks, Sam. I'm just going to build on that a little bit. You know, 1919, the first film about the Armenian genocide came out, called Ravished Armenia. The intent was to tell the story of the Armenian genocide. It was a narrative film, not testimony per se. But 100 years later, we were still battling for recognition of the Armenian genocide. So as much as we hope that the ways in which we portray the past through film and video is going to work, it is really it's a function of what's happening in society and politics rather than the actual media itself. The first testimony of the Holocaust was taken on the 24th of April, 1945. The person who gave that testimony was Helle Goldstein. I tripped across this in a British movie tone reel a few years ago. I went into the Shoah Foundation's archive, which has a very powerful search tool, and looked up Helle Goldstein, just on the off chance you might have given a testimony later. And what popped up, because the metadata was working for us, was that a former Helle Goldstein had given a testimony in Houston, Texas in 1996 under the name Helen Collin. I tracked her down, I went to visit her and sat with her and said, "Do you remember the day that you gave this testimony?" And she was standing in front of a mass grave with 5,000 corpses behind her on her 21st birthday. She remembered it very well, of course. And she said, I said to her, "What was going through your mind?" And she said, "I assumed I was going to die." I said, "Die?" And she said, "Well, yeah, because standing in front of me were the former SS that the British had rounded up. And until a few days previously, they had been the masters of life and death." He said, "So for me to stand in front of the camera was a choice to die for the purpose of giving testimony." I was in a refugee camp about 3 years ago, just after the Rohingya were, well, actually during the time when the Rohingya were crossing the water from Myanmar into Bangladesh. And I sat with Imam Sadiq. Imam Sadiq's wife had been gang raped, two of his four children had been murdered in front of his eyes, and he'd just arrived in Cox's Bazar. And I asked him whether he was willing to give testimony, and he gave the exact same comment. He said, "Even if I die for it, it is worth it because we have to tell the truth." All of this to underpin the question, Claire, that you're asking. I believe that the Shoah Foundation's archive, for example, of 55,000 testimonies, is there not only to tell the truth, it's the truths of the individuals and what they went through. There's all sorts of issues around historicity and facticity, and we can nitpick about that from morning till night. And I write about those sorts of issues because human memory is fallible. But taken together, the collective truth, if we can protect it, is indeed a very strong bastion against denial. It doesn't mean that the deniers themselves will believe it or accept it. But for the 180 million minutes of testimony that were viewed on our platform last year, I believe that's 180 million minutes of truth telling, which actually I think can help us to shore up that, you know, that avalanche of denial that we've been witnessing in the digital space, provided that.
Thanks, Stephen. So we're hearing two dynamics. One is this notion of the liar's dividend, that you don't even need a convincing AI-generated deepfake to sow doubt about real evidence. So this claim that if I just say the testimonies at the Shoah Foundation are fake and say they're AI-generated, Holocaust deniers can promulgate that narrative. But we're also trying to anticipate emergent threats in the actual deepfake realm. So how is synthetic media actually being used today for both positive and negative use cases, which will help us forecast, I think, how to preserve the power of the video that Stephen and Sam were describing. So maybe to suspend some of the questions, the order of the questions I gave the panelists in advance of this meeting, maybe Salila, Lisa, or Chris, whoever wants to chime in, just about what do we see in terms of how are deepfakes used? Has the liar's dividend been relied upon in any examples that you know of? Just ground us in what's actually happening with AI generated and manipulated media today.
I'll just throw some ideas.
And maybe we'll start with Lisa, because she has her 2 cents. Yes, go ahead.
Thanks, Salila. Look, I think one space where we have seen this technology used nefariously but effectively is in the space of intimate image abuse, which is an issue that Bumble cares deeply about and regularly surveys our customers on. And our customers, the majority of whom respond to these types of surveys are women, say that the issue of intimate image abuse is one that keeps them awake at night, and in fact has such a negative impact on their daily lives that they pull back from their use of the internet and its tools. So they report to us that they spend either out of fear of being a victim of intimate image abuse, or because they have already been victims of intimate image abuse, that they end up disengaging from public spaces online, which I think have really profound implications, given that we use the internet for every aspect of our modern lives and has a direct impact on women's earning potential and their careers. Intimate image abuse has lots of permutations, but one particularly pernicious one is in the area of deep fake porns and deep fake intimate images. And so essentially what this means is that with a click of a button, any individual that has access to the internet and a photo of a fully clothed woman can replicate and reproduce that woman's face so convincingly in an intimate image, otherwise a naked photo, or render it into pornography such that an unsuspecting viewer will have no ability to detect or identify whether that image or video is actually accurate depiction of this woman or not. As you can imagine, this has lots of negative implications for the women involved who report feeling some of the same feelings as though that woman were actually involved in an intimate act and had that intimate act leaked to the entire public. So that's sort of one way that this is being used. But one aspect of this that I would love to highlight here is that another challenge, so now you have either an intimate photo or video of you engaging in a sexual act which you did not consent to, and now that it's out there on the open internet, there is almost no way to get that content removed. So women currently have to go to each individual platform or company and find that piece of content and request that that content be removed. And then depending on the platform's policies, she will either know that it is being removed or it isn't. But there is actually, it is much far more likely that that piece of content will remain live on the internet in perpetuity. And so I raise that because I think that that provides a case study of how this kind of technology can be used for nefarious purposes, and then the challenges of what to do about it and how to get it off the internet.
Maybe actually, so Yair, I may pass it to you after that. And if we're hearing that a lot of the use cases for deep fakery today are in other domains, so they're not used, we don't see a Holocaust deep fake, why might we still be worried about what do we see today in terms of the techniques that Holocaust deniers use? Do they manipulate images? What do you see as someone who's a very online person who probably gets a lot of fodder on your Twitter? Can you describe some instances? Have you seen a deep fake directed at you that's anti-Semitic in nature? And what do you actually see on the ground?
I mean, I can't speak to every form of Holocaust denial or every form of prejudice, but the Holocaust deniers themselves are not, taking Schindler's List and reversing the characters, which would take, I think, a little bit of technological know-how beyond their ken. And it's also not necessary because to circle back to what I mentioned before, you don't need something highly sophisticated, as has been mentioned, to cast doubt on a historical event. In fact, all you need is a few data points that you pull out of their context, and then you start exposing people to them and misrepresenting what they mean. So to put this very concretely, you will have people who will point out that historically there were agreements between some Jews, including some Jews in Israel, and the Nazis in order to pay off the Nazis to get some Jews out of the places where they were being murdered. And so what was going on there historically, of course, is that Jews were being put into these impossible positions where they knew people were getting killed and mass murdered. And you had this choice: do you sort of work with the Nazis and the ones who are willing to work with you in order to get some of those people out and save their lives, right? But at the risk, you are giving them, you know, money or other help, right? And so it's, you know, there's no good options. And some, you know, this was a heated debate within the Jewish community, and some people went one way and some people went the other, and it continues to be debated. What is going on here, of course, is not the Jews perpetrating the Holocaust with the Nazis. But if you pull that data point out of its historical and moral context, and you throw it at people, you can say, look, here are Jews collaborating with the Nazis. They did the Holocaust, but you didn't know that. And this is the form in which these sorts of things take. And so that's what I think, and that's, of course, what I'm describing there is text-based stuff. You're less likely to see some big fancy doctored image. You're more likely to see some real image misrepresented. So this is a guy and it's a Nazi, but I'm calling him George Soros and things like that.
I'd love to build on that point, maybe from the policy and technology angle. So Salila, if we're hearing that there are lots of these low tech manipulations that can mislead, how do you deal with that from a policy perspective, accommodating all the types of techniques that might mislead and even defining what misleading content is? Because as Yair is describing, I think there's some truth to a lot of the denialism we see online. And maybe Chris afterward, from a technical angle, what tools do we have at our disposal to actually combat deep fakery and cheap fakery, which is the term for lower tech manipulations?
Thanks, Claire. And to build on what Yair was just sharing, you know, the prevalence of sort of very sophisticated media, sort of what people would describe as a technical deepfake. So not a quote unquote cheap fake that people may have heard about. That is actually not very widespread. And what the platforms have done is focus on sort of media collaborations. They've focused on fact checking, et cetera, to sort of have a place, a third party place to send content that's in dispute for verification. The problem, of course, is that you can't necessarily do this at scale. This is very whack-a-mole. This is very piece by piece, and it's not necessarily satisfying. And what time has shown in the period in which we've had this growth and of application in manipulated media around the world, both in benign circumstances and in more nefarious ones, to use your term, Claire, is the need for multiple checks across society. So you have policies, for example. Facebook was the first major tech platform to launch a manipulated media policy in January of 2020. And there you had a combination of focusing on videos specifically that had been edited or synthesized beyond adjustments for clarity or quality that were not apparent to an average person. And the use of the average person was very intentional because there are different layers of sophistication in how people across the digital divide perceive media. And would it mislead the average person to believe that a subject of a video said something that they didn't say? And was it a product of artificial intelligence? And that policy wasn't as far-reaching as it could have been for a whole host of reasons, but it sort of goes to the complexity of having a one-size-fits-all solution, and that's really not possible. To counterbalance the very compelling examples that Lisa was talking about non-consensual intimate imagery, we also have a prevalence now of artificial intelligence being used in very benign ways, but that are causing uncertainty. And I'll give you an example straight from the tech gadget headlines of the past several weeks, which is to say, for example, Samsung just launched a really cool new phone. And with this really cool new phone, you have amazing photographic capabilities. And one of those is a magnified lens with which you can take pictures of the moon. And with this new phone, people have been taking pictures of the moon. And it's launched this really intense debate among people saying these are doctored images of the moon taken by this phone. And you've had media outreach to Samsung to have their engineers explain how AI is being used in this phone. And is it enabling random lay people with this device to create deep fake images of the moon that aren't authentic and that aren't real? And this is a very benign example, but it's showing you how pervasive in our day-to-day lives these discussion points here are today. And it really makes us want to take a step back, take a deep breath, and realize how important it is to look at different sources of technology, look at different sources of policy, and ask what makes sense here. And one point that maybe we could talk about in the moments we have left is just transparency. So what's the solution, for example, in a Samsung example, right? Like, is it a little footnote saying that this was used with enhanced with AI capability? Is that too much noise for the person looking at the picture of the moon, as blurry as it might be? And so these are the kinds of solutions and applications that I think we should think about. But to go back to the purpose of this specific discussion and authenticating memory, whether we're talking about the Rohingya or whether we're talking about Holocaust survivors, is there are certain examples of media production where we do want that authenticity stamp. And what can we do as a society collectively to make sure that that's happening in the best way possible?
So maybe, Chris, really briefly, if you can describe some of the limitations of technology for dealing with deepfakes. And then Stephen, I'd love to hear about some of the new techniques and technologies that we're exploring to verify or certify testimony and other forms of video.
Yeah, so there's a lot of research to build detectors that can infer if something is fake. Unfortunately, they have false positives and false negatives. Every detector, there's no silver bullets. And sometimes even Sam was discussing this a lot. They fuel even false narratives like liar dividend, where there was one detector out there that's public domain that said this is fake, but it was not fake. And then a journalist claimed it was fake. And it's very dangerous to trust those detectors without any other signals. The other technology that we talked about several times here is provenance. There are many different ways to do this. Reverse image search is always used in fact checks. So you want to find the original image that educates the public. Then, I understand why this is fake or not. I don't have to trust an AI. There's also, I want to go back quick and then I wrap up this moon shot. In 2019, there was another cell phone vendor, which I don't name, actually replaced the moon with the wrong craters, you know? So some artist put up a fake moon in front of the camera and it outputted the real moon. So you can Google this, you know? Lots of things to talk about technology and the limitations of it, but I'll wrap it up here.
And Chris, thank you for that as well. And I think, you know, it does merit the time to go into what those technologies are, because of course they are an important defense against this manipulation. So one of the projects that I mentioned at the top of the program, and that I'll just expand on a little bit, is it perhaps in answer to some of the conversation we've been having here. One of the things that we've been most concerned about is authenticity in terms of, as content gets produced in real time, how do we know that the original source material is what we are now looking at? And so the Starling Lab, which was the genius of Jonathan Dotan, who was doing a fellowship at Stanford and started working with the engineering department there, came to us at the Shoah Foundation concerned about chain of custody and also the preservation of our current archive that we have. How do you make sure that that remains authentic from this point going forward? And then as new content is collected, how can you verify that? So this blockchain technology that we call the Starling framework isn't called the USC Shoah Foundation Framework for Digital Preservation and Integrity, because actually we see it as a universal technology that needs to be deployed and can be deployed as an open source technology. The purpose of that is as follows, and I just need to clarify for you, I am a trained theologian. So as I get deep into technology, you should trust me less and less the more I say, but I'll have a go. So the image is coming into the camera. The camera could be a phone, it could be a DSLR, it could be a video camera. And the idea is to create middleware in the camera itself. So at the point of collection, the video or photograph or image is encrypted at the point of collection. What that means then, as well as the metadata which you currently have stamped on every image you take, place and time, you will have a blockchain encryption code which will tag it with other metadata. That metadata is not alterable. What's important about that is then you can then take that image directly from the camera and encrypt it onto blockchain. Blockchain, as we know, is used for cryptocurrencies and other other technologies that require high levels of security and authentication, and they also have an owner. And the owner in this case would be the owner of the original source, who will then have the ability to de-encrypt that back into whatever platform we want to do. So why is that important? One of the two initial pilot projects of Starling were, first of all, to take three cameras, one in Los Angeles, filming a Holocaust survivor, two, in Iraq, filming a Kurd coming across the border, having just come across the border from northern Syria last year. Three, in the Amazonian rainforests for a community that was being destroyed. Each of those cameras filmed testimony in that pilot and were encrypted directly into blockchain. Second pilot project was from the end of the election last year until the inauguration, 78 days between the two. And Reuters were equipped with cameras that would enable them to place their content onto blockchain. As it happens, one of those cameras and one of those journalists was at the insurrection on January the 6th, which means the images taken by that journalist on that day that were encrypted using the Starling framework were committed to blockchain on January the 6th. And we now know that whatever manipulation happens around that particular historical event, of which there has been much already, those particular images can be traced back to source. And it's probably the first historical event that has been committed to blockchain at source. So that's the idea behind Starling. It's one that we're very pleased to collaborate with our panelists on today and with you, Claire, because this is something that while the Shoah Foundation has a use case in terms of protecting Holocaust and genocide testimony, others like Sam and the amazing team at Witness, you know, might be able to use this, for example, as they go out and share this technology with people all around the globe. So that's one technology that we're hoping, Chris, might be a defense mechanism that would then pair up with the kind of technologies you're working on to identify and mitigate.
Thanks, Stephen.
Yeah, just quickly, this is great. I know about this technology. There's Adobe, there's C2PA, there's BBC, Partnership for AI, Witness. It's over the last few years, we saw like an increase in provenance frameworks. I don't want to be the devil's advocate right now. Maybe Sam wants to say even that can be weaponized provenance, but it's a much more solid framework that sort of shows to society, oh, okay, we don't have to trust the black box AI anymore. So I'm totally, thank you for bringing this up. I'm totally for it.
Sam, if you want to offer just a few more thoughts, because you're involved in a lot of the standards efforts for authentication.
Yeah. No, and it's, I think it's a really important set of efforts because it's also about helping people assert the truth for themselves or share content and put indices of trust in it. So if we want to assume that people want to demonstrate it, and Witness has worked in this area for about a decade building tools. And most recently, we've been part of a number of the big initiatives in this area. There's one called the Content Authenticity Initiative, another called the Coalition for Content Provenance and Authenticity. And the part that we've been very involved in recently, and actually the public specs are available for comment, has actually been trying to understand the trade-offs in building these tools. And I think they're a very powerful solution for helping people assert confidence in their material. But we have to be also thinking, do we want to create a world where these become much more de facto, an expectation that people have these signals, for example? Often this data can be very privacy compromising. If we look in authoritarian context, you have to balance out expectations of what governments may ask of tool manufacturers who start to create these tools. So I would actually put this out as something for the audience and for panelists that actually the commentary is now available for folks to comment on these public specifications and the potential ways to really get the balance right between creating these powerful tools to assert confidence in testimonies and evidence, while making sure we don't inadvertently disadvantage people who may not have access to these tools, may not want to use them for very legitimate reasons, or may find their governments use them against it. I'll drop a link in the chat to a report that really tries to analyze these types of trade-offs and how we make them right to counter deepfakes, but also to deal with this broader phenomenon that Yair was describing. We've really been putting our finger on that most media is not deepfakes, it's more simple forms of miscontextualization and manipulation, and the provenance tools are also very much aimed at those types of approaches, and trying to think about how you help people have a better source of information should they wish to look at it to understand where media has come from and how it's been manipulated over time.
And Claire, a super fast point, not to complicate matters, but one thing to think about is, you know, if you had that stamp, like this is a real thing, people can doctor that stamp and create a fake version of that stamp too and apply it to something that is fake and say, look, no, this is the real stamp on it. And so there's a chain that you could follow that Sam alluded to. Thanks.
Yeah, so I just wanted to take 1 minute quick step back for some people who might be on this on this call here and be a little bit confused about what we're talking about when we say the words provenance architecture, which is something that is very familiar to people in the technology and some of the journalism space, but isn't actually very familiar, I think, to most of my readers, say. And provenance architecture is an attempt to answer the question of how do we tell people what's true when people are often distrustful of, say, outside fact checkers who show up and say, well, this thing is correct, but this isn't. And then someone says, well, who says, right? And why should I trust you? So that doesn't really solve the problem. What might solve the problem is if you gave people easy to use tools and signals that allowed them to just figure out for themselves, where did this information come from? So here's an image. We're going to keep going back to this example, which is I'm stealing really from an article Claire wrote. I'm going to be open about this, where you have this image of a Nazi and next to it, it says, this is George Soros, the Jew who collaborated with the Nazis. So imagine if when that picture was put online, there was a certain amount of metadata that was stuck into the picture that every single web browser and anywhere else you put it would be able to read that would say, this photo was taken at such and such a time by such and such a person. And it's actually of, you know, so-and-so X the Nazi, who clearly is not George Soros, right? So no one has to tell someone, no one has to fact check that meme or that image. The people can literally, just like you can like save an image file on your computer and see all sorts of things like how big it is, right, in size and in file size and all sorts of other stuff, you'll also be able to see all of this data. And that sort of stuff, if you have global standards on it, just like we have global standards on many other things, will enable people to sort of decide and, you know, look at information themselves. And when a meme comes to their way or an image or a questionable claim, they can actually take the pieces and look back themselves because the stuff will be built in to, say, their web browser. But what was being alluded to by Sam is that this is a really powerful tool for helping us to figure out what's true and giving people those tools. But at the same time, imagine you're working out of an authoritarian country where if you identified yourself and I took this photo of this abuse at such and such a time in such and such a place, well, you've just exposed yourself, right, to tremendous retaliation and danger. Or if you're in a poorer country or in a place where you're more compromised and you just don't have access to this sort of technology, so then can you not contribute to the global conversation because people won't believe you, right? And so there are these trade-offs and these questions that are being asked by a lot, some of the people on this panel. And that I think is an extraordinarily important conversation as a journalist, I think that we should be having. We shouldn't be paralyzed by the questions. We should see them as opportunities to figure out what would work best for them, for most people.
So we've moved from a notion that there will be a purely technical, perfect solution to dealing with denial and preservation there, right, to the introduction of a socio-technical one with lots of complexity, but a lot of promise too. So in closing, before we move to one question and we're gonna wrap up on time, I'd love to end on a slightly positive note and turn to each panelist and say, kind of, you know, amidst these daunting issues, what is something you are hopeful for in terms of the future of this field, the future of audiovisual testimony and technology and history. Maybe we'll start with Lisa.
Thanks. I would say that from my time working in big tech and now at a small tech company, what has really amazed me is that often in the public discourse, we talk about tech as being unresponsive to outside forces, to the considerations of governments and citizens and civil society. And I will say that I have found the exact opposite to be true. That lots of change, over my very brief time in tech, I've seen companies make lots of big changes, and they are often the result of these types of conversations with experts, with concerned citizens, and with governments. And so I think that's something to be hopeful about.
Wonderful, Lisa. And maybe we'll go Salila, Chris, Yair, Sam, Stephen. If we can remember that order or just defy it.
I'll echo what Lisa said. I think the conversation today is a really good example of bringing people from diverse backgrounds who have touched on this space and intersected on this space and thought about it from different perspectives. And the answer is not black and white, but that doesn't mean, oh, let's just talk about it some more. That means, well, let's find solutions that work for different applications in different spaces. And, you know, the word, again, I said it before, I'll just close with it again, the multi-stakeholderism of this particular space is extraordinary and it's global. And Sam and others have written about how a solution that might apply in a very tech advanced space might not apply in places where technology is not as widespread and where there will have disparate impacts if we apply it in a certain way. And I think having those considerations in our minds, regardless of where we are, understanding that there's no one technological solution or one policy solution, but that doesn't mean that we abandon application entirely, but that we are be very careful in our application is really critical. And huge thanks to the Shoah Foundation for having this type of multidisciplinary discourse. We need more of this at an academic level, but also at a social level. And people like Yair and Claire and others, you know, advancing these discussions for multiple audiences is really critical. So thanks again to the audience who joined today and to the panelists. I think that this is the future, and this is what gives me hope specifically.
I forgot my order too, so why don't we go to Sam?
I'm gonna plus one in the classic internet phrase to both Lisa and Salila about the need to, and I think some of the opportunities we've seen in the deepfake space to have a conversation around some of these issues to try and prevent harms. I think too often we think about technologies after the fact and after the horse has bolted, and also from a perspective that's very US and European centric. I would also say, I think we should think about deepfakes and their creative potential in a couple of areas. We're already seeing fresh shoots. Witness has been working with MIT on a report coming out around satire. Now, obviously satire can be gaslighting, it can be malicious, but it can also be a tremendous weapon of the weak, and deepfakes lend themselves to that. And also for privacy protection. We've seen tremendous usages of deepfakes, for example, in the film Welcome to Chechnya, to protect the identities of vulnerable LGBTQ activists, sharing their stories. So let's also keep alive to the possibilities, the creative possibilities in synthetic media, and in fact, the human rights and testimonial possibilities.
Yair, and then Chris.
Yeah, I think that what Sam is getting at is that technologies aren't good or bad. They're as good or as bad as the people using them. And we can come up with more productive ways to use all of the tools that we're discussing. And that, as you can hear when we talk about these new things that many of you may never have heard about, like something like provenance architecture, the way something has been is not the way that it has to be. And we are perfectly capable. The internet has changed dramatically in the last 5 years, the last 10 years, the last 15. There is no particular reason why we cannot make it better. And we cannot make it healthier. And we cannot make it easier for people to figure out what is true and what is not. Sometimes there is this sense of fatalism. But often with the right amount of creativity and intention, just as that sort of creativity and intention has changed the internet before, it can change it again.
I quickly agree with everything. 50,000 years ago, we invented language. Then we invented the written word. We didn't stop talking. We didn't stop writing just because we figured out people are in denial and lying. Synthetic media is a new form, and it has more positive societal use cases. We just need to be responsible. That's it.
I'll wrap up, Claire. Thank you so much for the opportunity to partner with you on this program today, and for our panelists for bringing such pertinent and important issues to the fore. I'm hopeful because 10 years ago, when we first started sharing the Shoah Foundation testimonies, we were a little worried about what would happen on the internet. And within the first year, we got attacked very badly by a Holocaust denier when we put the first 100 testimonies up. So we thought that was going to be our existence. Since then, tens of millions of people use those testimonies every year, and we get virtually no abuse, maybe in comments. But the community, there may be bad actors out there, but there's a very good community out there, and we trust our community. We trust our young users. We give them the digital tools and the digital literacy, and they are so responsible, and they are such good digital citizens. We've got to have our defenses up, but we've also just got to take the good out of this and use technology and deploy it for the benefit of humanity, and just keep trusting it, because it's all to play for. And I'm so grateful that our colleagues here have given us such good guidance today on how to think about these things. And please, let's get back together again. We just got started.
And in the interest of telling the truth, that we will answer your questions, but also, I guess, we're not telling the truth, that we're going to end on time. We have one question that we're going to take, which hopefully will push us closer towards that not perfect or black and white solution, but getting into the real nuance of what we need to drive towards in deepfake solutions. So we have a question from the audience, which says, where does the liar's dividend end and free speech begin? People who politically support efforts to preserve or verify testimony may not be comfortable with the suppression of speech. And we'll maybe turn this to one panelist if they want to answer, if we have a volunteer. If not, I may delegate the question to one person. It's a big question.
I mean, it's a little hard to understand the question. What is the person saying? The first part of it, I thought I understood, but then they say people who support preserving, you know, Holocaust testimony and other historical truths may not support the suppression of speech. That would be me. And I think most of the people in this room, the conversation we're having is not, and I think the question probably came up a little bit earlier before we got to things like provenance architecture. One of the useful things about giving the source of information to people is it allows them to make their own determinations. And you know, instead of saying that we're going to have some external body that is the arbiter of ultimate truth, which is a very hard thing, as Cecilia said, to actually scale, even if you could do it, and even if these weren't incredibly difficult and complicated questions. But what you can do is make the information a lot easier to understand and to access and to verify. And so that is a way of saying, instead of closing off avenues of speech, it's opening up avenues of inquiry. So that's, I would say, a lot of where I think some of the conversation is going. So I can't speak for everyone else, but I certainly don't support suppressing speech. And I don't think that you have to do that in order to solve these things. And I don't think it works. I've written about this in other contexts. Suppressing speech rarely actually solves the problem. It just suppresses the symptom, right, while the problem continues. So that's what we're trying to find, is better solutions than that.
Thanks, Yair. And I agree with Stephen's comment in the chat. What a quick hour that was. We're hopeful we will be able to have follow-up conversations. And I also want to thank all the people who were working behind the scenes. Of course, thank you to these panelists for taking an hour out of their busy day to offer their wisdom. It's heartening to be with this multidisciplinary group. I wish we could spend more time together. But also I want to thank Fatima Kittig at the Shoah Foundation, as well as Claudia Weidman, for a lot of their work behind the scenes, and many people at PAI, Andrea Cross, our Director of Communications, and Josh Pikus for supporting me on this event as well. There are many folks who made this happen. So thanks so much. There's some resources in the chat, and we look forward to staying in touch with everyone and taking on these challenges all together.
Thank you. See you soon.
Bye.